From BYU Radio's performance studio, this is Highway 89. I'm Stephen Kapp Perry. In the studio today, we've got Micky and the Motorcars, a touring band whose hometown is pretty much America. From the Sawtooth Mountains of Stanley, Idaho, to downtown Nashville, and even Austin city limits, they play 200 days a year, jamming in every nook in the nation. The torrent of music the band produces is like a tumbleweed in the tornado. They've released 7 full-length records, including their latest, we're going to hear from it, Hearts From Above, and during their recent European tour, they laid down live tracks for their next project. Today is a totally unplugged 3-man version of their usual 5-man stage show. We've got Micky Braun, the band's frontman, vocals and guitar, his brother Gary singing harmony, sometimes leads, and Dustin Shaefer also on guitar. We're going to kick things off with the title song from their latest release. On the album version, you'll hear all 4 Braun brothers singing, something that hasn't happened in the studio since they were teenagers. We'll talk more about that family history of music, but we'll kick it off with Hearts From Above.
1, 2, 3, 4. In these boots of mine, I walk in love. The way the leaves, shadows cast, look like hearts from above. Hearts from above, descending upon me. Hearts from above, sending your side, from the other side of the city. I can hear your heart call out to me. Let the truth be the judge and you will see. I was made for you and we were meant to be. Baby, I can feel you all the way in. Baby, I can feel you all the way. Baby, I can feel you all the way from the other side of the city. Days go by and the sun does too. My mind keeps wandering back to you. Back to you. It's where I want to be. Back to you. In your arms of glory, wrapped up tight in your arms of glory. I can hear your heart call out to me. Let the truth be the judge and you will see. I was made for you and we were meant to be. Baby, I can feel you all the way. Baby, I can feel you all the way. Baby, I can feel you all the way from the other side of the city. Yeah, this city, sometimes Salt Lake City.
That's Hearts From Above, the title track of Micky and the Motorcars' latest album, performed just now in studio here on Highway 89. Micky Braun, lead vocals, acoustic guitar. I really like Hearts From Above. I love the album cover.
Thank you.
With the, it reminds me of the candy bomber.
Yeah, right?
Little hearts falling down on parachutes from
right?
everywhere.
Yeah.
Tell me about writing that, because I heard you kind of got inspired by hearing one of your heroes play.
I did. I was actually at an Alejandro Escovedo show in Austin, where we live, and down at the good old Continental Club watching him play. And after the show, I was walking home, and just kind of was really inspired by his show. So on the walk back, I started thinking about a melody that I really had kind of been working on already, but just started putting words together. And by the time I got home, I kind of had a verse, the first verse kind of written, and sat down and started writing it until I was too tired to stay up. And then
is that sort of the songwriter's curse? You're always working on something.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of is. You wake up in the middle of the night sometimes, and if you don't get up and write it down, you won't remember it the next day. So you kind of do have to, I do anyway, I have to get up. I don't have the brain capacity to to hold on to the lines that I like and the melodies. So I do, I'll get up and record something on my phone or write it down at least just to get it locked in.
Hey, we were also impressed that with playing 200 shows a year, you're still going to shows.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, that's, I think that's one of the biggest parts of being a musician is always to keep your band fresh and keep your songs fresh. You should always be out watching other people and seeing what they do and how they entertain a crowd. And, you know, we went and saw Bruce Springsteen not too long ago in Houston, and you know, he puts on one of the best shows on the road, and it really inspires you to go out and try and do the best you can and keep.
He does like 3 hours.
Oh, it's ridiculous. He works way too hard.
Well, tell me about this new album. This seems, you know, every life has its ups and downs, mm-hmm. and so do the fortunes of a group that stays together for a long time. You've Absolutely. Had some albums on the darker side. Mm-hmm. This seems to be hitting the other side of the meter.
Yeah, I think that the group of guys that I was writing with on this record and just the place that I was at in my life. I just got married and I've just had a really good last few years. And the guys in the band right now are all not quite as tired as we were on the last record, you know. So there was a really nice freshness going on with everybody it just helped out in the songwriting side of it for me to kind of write some more upbeat, kind of happier stuff.
So I'd also read that when you were narrowing it down, whittling it down from mm-hmm. about 35 songs, which yeah. I don't know if people know how many songs yeah. get written that don't get used.
Yeah, there's a lot of them out there that you know, I think most bands and most songwriters do that same thing. They all write a bunch of tunes, and then you collectively figure out which ones fit together the best for that album.
Okay, but the line we liked best that we found online, was, maybe this was you who said that, typing all their lyrics up and making sure they weren't too cheesy. Were there some yeah. that just didn't pass the cheese test?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I definitely write a lot of songs that after I start playing it, I listen to it back on a recording, and I go, gosh, that's horrible. Why would you think that? You know, but I think that All songwriters do write a certain amount of songs, and they all can't be, you know, on that top 10 list, you know, and that's part of being a writer. I think if you're writing children's books or what you're doing, you have to go through a lot of really bad stuff to get to a small amount of good stuff.
Hey, I wonder have you been surprised by reaction from someone who heard a song and just they interpret it their own way? It means something different than you even thought of.
My wife does that a lot.
Well, let's start right at home. Okay.
Yeah, she's pretty funny. She's always asking me questions about, what's that song about? I think, and then she's, I go, I ask her, I go, what do you think it's about? And I'm like, you're way off. But no, a lot of people do that. A lot of people come up and say, hey, man, I really love the way that you wrote a song about this or that. And I sometimes I just let it go and just go, yeah, well, awesome. I love your take on it.
You guys have been playing forever. Mm-hmm. Do you remember the first time you were on a stage performing for somebody?
I actually don't. Just from pictures, the only thing that I actually have. There's a photo of me on stage with my dad and my brothers, and I was probably about 5 years old, and right around there. And I don't remember it because it was so long ago. But I do remember starting when we started getting on stage a lot and playing with the family band. And I remember when I first started learning how to play bass, I was probably about six or seven.
Yeah,
right,
almost as
there.
Tall as the bass. Why not? Why not pick it up?
Right. Yeah.
So tell me about the Everly Brothers show, because you must have been pretty young for this.
I was. I think I was 6 or 7 also, right around that same time frame when Mom and Dad brought us to see the Everly Brothers in Boise, Idaho, and we just listened to them around the clock on that. We had their records and their tapes, so they were a big influence on just what we listened to growing up with their harmonies and their songwriting. And we, you know, worked up a couple of their tunes and tried to
good harmonies.
Oh, the best, I think.
But I heard also they broke a string, and you thought it was pretty cool what they did.
Yeah, that was, it was the first time I ever saw anybody throw a guitar on stage. It was the first rock and roll move I ever got to witness.
And not to smash it.
No, not at all. They just thing. He broke the string and just took the guitar off and threw it over to their guitar tech on the side of the stage, and the other guy brought another guitar right out to
and they probably just
I don't remember if it was Don or Phil actually that did that, but it was really cool. And their piano player laid down on his back and played piano upside down and did all kinds of cool rock and roll stuff that we'd never really seen before. So it was our first experience outside of just watching, you know, Dad play guitar on the stool or whatever, you know.
Well, good. Let's cool. We're going to hear some more. We'll let you take your place over there. You can play on your back if you want.
I think I'll just stay in the chair.
Very good. We're excited to hear Carolina Morning. There's a great song line in this song. Check out Music Grow in Opryland and get to know my friends. And I have to tell you, we'll tell you more about the family history. But as kids, Micky and Gary Braun performed with their father and their brothers. They performed at the Grand Ole Opry, and they certainly had friends on Music Grow, including people like Johnny Cash. Even though they didn't have a TV growing up, they were on TV twice playing the Carson Show. How would that be? You've been on TV more than you've... Maybe we'll talk about that. But their neighbors get quite a show, too, usually seeing them perform in the back of a flatbed pickup truck. This is Carolina Morning.
One, two, three, four, one. Girl, when I left you, my poor old heart was breaking. Because I know your love for me is right. But the sun's gonna rise on you in Carolina. It's gonna set on me in Tennessee tonight. Yeah, I've had Carolina mornings and California nights. Times and places in between I found to be alright. But it feels so good that it's understood I should without a warning. And I love you on a Carolina morning. Tomorrow night I lay for California. After that I might go home to Idaho. But the sun's gonna rise on you in Carolina. And girl, where it sits on me I just don't know. Yeah, I've had Carolina mornings and California nights. Times and places in between I found to be alright. But it feels so good that it's understood I show up without a warning. And I'll love you on a Carolina morning. Sunshine. Oh. Check out Music Row in Opryland, and you can get to know my friends. The more the life
likely I'd just show up without a warning. And I love you on a Carolina morning. Yeah, yeah, Carolina mornings and California nights. Times and places in between I found it'd be alright. But it feels so good that it's understood I should without a warning. And I love you on a Carolina morning. It feels so good that it's understood I should without a warning. And I love you on a Carolina morning.
Let's take it home, boys.
Carolina Morning, performed live in studio by Micky and the Motorcars. This is BYU Radio's Highway 89 live music program. I'm Stephen Kapp Perry. Gary Braun does the vocals, he sings harmonies, and he's playing acoustic guitar right now, but you play a lot of other instruments. I'm also seeing a harmonica on the floor. I assume that's not just a stand for your phone there.
Yeah, we're probably going to play some harmonica
all right,
towards
well,
the end.
I'm looking forward to that. That'll be fun to hear. You guys are used to playing in all different configurations, from the big family band. Sometimes you and Micky travel as a duo, I've read.
Yeah, we do a few acoustic shows here and there when sometimes the venues, it's more appropriate for a smaller, more intimate type of show. And then we do a lot of jamming with my brothers and my dad and stuff, too.
Okay, that leads me to the show I wish I could see, which is your family reunion.
Yeah, it should come up sometime.
Braun Brothers Reunion, Challis, Idaho. This is a big event. It's a concert. You don't want to hear the music at my family reunion. It's just like, well, so-and-so had a tap number, and she'll get up there, you know.
Yeah.
And, well, there are 30 other girls, so the wave part won't look so good. Anyway, you guys really put on a show. Tell me about this. I mean, you invite other people to this.
Yeah, it's started out kind of my dad and his brothers had a band in the late 80s and stuff, and then they broke up and started having families and stuff, and then they thought it'd be fun to get together once a year and do a show, and so they started doing it real small in Stanley. And then we kind of grew up and started playing and started bringing our bands out from Texas and then started bringing our friends and all those guys out to join us. And it just kind of went from a one-day show to a three-day festival with about 5,000 people pretty quick.
I hope you don't have to feed everybody.
No, we have a hot dog stand.
You can make a little money on the side there.
Yeah.
I heard that it goes on rain or shine.
It does. We've done it in the rain. We've had snow. Usually up there in that country, the weather blows through real quick. You know, it doesn't typically rain all day. It'll do, you know, a little kind of probably like it does here. It'll rain for 20 minutes, and then it could be sunny and 80 the next, you know, 20 minutes later. So,
hey, the video for the song we're going to hear in just a minute, Long Road to Nowhere, is that all in Idaho?
Yeah, we filmed all that right by Challis there at the Braun Brothers Reunion and then up at my parents' ranch just about between Stanley and Challis.
It looked pretty comfortable.
Yeah.
Like, you guys just sort of said, well, just follow us around doing what we normally do.
Yeah, well, we got kind of lucky because we had our friends from the Texas music scene were up filming the event. And so since we had all the cameras and the crew there, we talked them into shooting our video for us. And that's pretty much what they did is they just followed us around for about 5 hours. and then they did a great job editing it and put it together for us.
Yeah, I've been watching that over and over. It makes me want to just take a trip somewhere.
Yeah.
Very nice. Hey, but I also wanted to ask, this is one of those songs that's got that, I mean, you are in a tour bus in the video, but it feels like a train. It's got that background rhythm, that ding-a-ding-a-ding-a-ding. Tell me about that.
Well, it's got a train beat, so that's probably where you kind of get that. And then I think we had our friend Buck who played accordion on that in the studio, so it kind of helps keep it moving a little bit. I think it gives it that nice flavor.
Well, let's hear it.
All right.
This is Long Road to Nowhere. You can Google the video if you want to see these guys in their natural habitat up in Idaho. I notice Micky even has a medallion hanging around his neck with the actual shape of the state of Idaho. It's got a little mark on it. Is that for where Stanley is?
Yeah, it's a heart.
It's a heart. Okay, good. Long Road to Nowhere. This is from their latest album, Hearts from Above. This song just hit number 8 on the Texas music chart and number 9 on Texas Regional Radio Report.
Yeah. Ready, boys? 1, 2, 3, 4. When I'm down on my luck, drowning in my head, there's nothing I can do. Another lonely ghost town, another empty bed. I was a fool for losing you. It's a long road to nowhere with a million miles to go. I reach for you. It's a long road to nowhere with a million miles to go. I reach for you, I reach for you. For your love, there's no one that knows me better than you. For your love, well, I've been broken down, scattered around, and I pick up the pieces and find my way back to you. In circles, the road it moves in songs, the saddest ones for you. And I know that I've been blind, girl, I know that I was wrong, stubborn through and through. It's a long road to nowhere with a million miles to go. I reach for you, I reach for your love. There's no one that knows me better than you. It's a long road to nowhere with a million miles to go. I reach for you, I reach for you.
Today in the BYU Radio Performance Studio, Micky and the Motorcars. That was Long Road to Nowhere, a song you can hear in its full, more electric, more percussive version on the band's recent album, Hearts from Above. This is Highway 89. Right now we're talking to guitarist Dustin Sunshine Shaefer, and he said, take it, Sunshine, during one of those, is this what you get called?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah,
where's this nickname from?
From the movie Remember the Titans.
Oh, yeah.
There's the guy that comes in about halfway through, California
with,
boy.
With
and
the
I
good
think
aim.
It was I think it was Cody.
Yeah, Cody or Willie.
One of their brothers was the initial person to dub me Sunshine, and it just kind of stuck.
Maybe it was the hair.
I think it was a lot the hair.
I don't know how your aim is with a football. If you can.
I'm pretty all right with the football.
So I heard you got an electric guitar for your 12th birthday, and that you just never stop playing it.
Pretty much.
And who's your guitar hero?
Oh, man, that's a tough one. I would say, like, the one dude that kind of got me into it was Eddie Van Halen. He's kind of my guy. But I've had a lot of different guys over the years. Like, as you get older and your tastes change, you know.
So did you learn his solos?
I learned a lot of their songs, note for note.
Man, not easy.
not easy, but I sat in my room for 2 hours a day, and, you know, so.
Do you have a favorite solo from a Van Halen solo?
Well, Eruption is pretty memorable. I mean, that's a two-minute guitar solo with nothing else but guitar.
Yeah, every guitarist should love that because they actually get to take the stage for a while.
Man, that's a tough one. Panama has a pretty cool solo in it. Just the whole song has a cool guitar part.
So I hear that you're the one in the band that actually was planning on a day job, the whole 9-to-5 thing. Going
yes.
to college mm-hmm. and all that.
Yeah, I went to college in Texas, in San Marcos, at Texas State University. Graduated in 2010. I got a degree in manufacturing engineering. And, you know, I just wasn't really, I didn't have a job offer out of college that just really jumped out at me. And this opportunity came up, and I took it and never looked back. And
okay,
the band ever since.
Is there some mechanical engineering part of your brain that every once in a while speaks up and says, "Are you crazy? What are you doing?"
No.
Okay.
No. No. Not really. Like, I feel like this is what I should be doing for sure.
So you joined the band. This is a band that has sort of a changing cast of characters now and then. Any band does. But my question for you about that is, we did just a rough count of past albums, came up with about 74 songs, and that's not counting anything that's new. But mm-hmm. are you ever on stage and someone calls out, "Do such and such," you know, from album 2 or 3? And what, do you have to know that, or you just sort of think it?
Not always. I mean, we can't play every song that people want to hear every night, you know, but we try to keep the popular ones in rotation, you know. But yeah, I don't know our whole entire catalog, you know. I learn them as they're necessary, but yeah, it's a lot of songs.
So I'm wondering also, when you come into a group that has people have heard a song on a record mm-hmm. and so they're expecting it's going to sound that way, but you probably don't want to play the exact notes every night. Or do you have to?
Well, you don't have to. But I think being a professional musician, you have to play what's on the record. You want to do the records justice, because when you go to a concert and you expect to hear something and it's different, it's not always good, you know. So,
like if they left out the solo on Eruption.
If you're expecting to hear a certain part or a certain lick or something, you know, like I do my best to recreate those parts as closely as the previous guitar players played them.
Yeah,
so.
And now you're the guy creating those parts for all the new stuff.
Yep.
So I also heard you got to go to Germany.
Mm-hmm.
First time traveling.
It was my first time.
We
went back in, I think, January of 2012. That was my first time to go.
And so do you feel like everybody understood all the lyrics?
They speak pretty good English over there, so.
Well, most people do. I guess I just wondered if it was different than it playing in a club where sometimes people are eating and talking while you're playing, or if people are coming just for the music.
The German audience is very attentive. Like they're there to listen to you. They don't talk while you're playing. They're not talking to their buddy or eating, yeah. or, you know, like they're zeroed in, and when you're done, they clap if you did a good job.
That's nice to be noticed, even when you stop, that someone notices you were playing.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
Well, let's hear some more music. We're going to let you take your place. That was Sunshine. That's Dustin Shaefer, one of the guitarists for Micky and the Motorcars. They've toured Europe 3 different times, and with the amount of band tours they're constantly going on, you could check them out online on their website, mickyandmotorcars.com. Find out where they're playing, because they do cover the U.S. from east to west. Here is Led Me the Wrong Way.
1, 2, 3, 4. Life's young and foolish, and I fell for your tricks. And you were bright and so brilliant, I didn't know when to quit. And you led me the wrong way when I needed you. You wanted forgiveness, I said we were through. You never did what you said you'd do. You led me the wrong way. Well, in 98, we two break. We made a promise and we made mistakes. And in good time, you were all mine. Just like before you walked out my door. And you led me the wrong way when I needed you. You wanted forgiveness, I said we were through. You never did what you said you'd do. You led me the wrong way. Gone and I'm alone. I spent some years out on the run, but my love was never enough. Led me the wrong way when I needed you. You wanted forgiveness, I said we were through. You never did what you said you'd do. You led me the wrong way. Led me the wrong way.
Here you go, boys.
Micky and the Motorcars performing an in-studio acoustic and unplugged version of Led Me the Wrong Way. You're listening to live music here on Highway 89 BYU Radio. Micky and Gary Braun, who are singing today, in fact, that was Gary doing lead on that last piece, they're brothers that are part of a larger musical legacy. So I want to go back. This is kind of weird to have the little music history lessons section, so I'm putting, getting out my chalkboard and my pointer here. But here's two generations back. Their granddad, greatest name ever, Eustatius.
Yeah.
Known as Musty Braun, he learned how to play the accordion from a mail-order lesson book. He grew up on a farm in North Dakota, not far from legendary bandleader Lawrence Welk. I mean, who's the neighbor of Lawrence Welk? He was also a relative. I think that's so great. In the 1950s, Musty moved his family from North Dakota to Twin Falls, Idaho. He played his Hammond B3 organ at Club 93 in Jackpot, Nevada, also a great name for a town in Nevada. And he built his three sons a stage in the basement of their home. And at Club 93, he put his organ, the Wurlitzer, spin it piano at an angle so he could play them both at the same time. That's a true gigging musician if you can do that. So here's a memory of the next generation. Musty has a son, Muzzy. What was his given name?
Michael.
Well, so of course, he's Muzzy.
Yeah, makes sense.
He talks about Musty covering everything from country to jazz to all the contemporary songs of the day, which were maybe Perry Como, Dean Martin, and the Beatles. And he had this library of music that was astounding. If anyone came up and made a request for a song, he had this huge alphabetized file system. He could reach over, pick out the song, and play it. And he says, I never saw my dad get stumped with a request for a song, ever. And I used to go down and watch him a lot. And that's a great musical legacy. So the Braun brothers were known for playing teen dances with their rock band called The Syndicate and segued into Western music, started playing the local rodeo and the fair circuit. Now Micky and Gary are the center of Micky and the Motorcars, and Gary and Cody are the heart of Reckless Kelly. So we're going to talk more, and you guys can correct me on any of this I got wrong. I want to know if you have nicknames pre-chosen for your kids someday, too. So we know they've got to be two-syllable M names, so we'll be working on that. But here's a great song called Long and Lonely Highway.
Said I'd never fall for you again. We were always gonna be friends. I knew it would be different than before, but that all changed when I walked out your door. Can't stop thinking about the old times. Yeah, I was running from the weather, and you were young and sweating innocence. I thought that we'd always end up together. And now down this long and lonely highway that I travel every night, from Jackpot down to Ely, it's like being in my hardest fights. Never really lost you, no. Yeah, 'cause you were never mine. And I was only chasing sweet dreams and hoping maybe they come true some other time. Yeah, maybe some other time. But not on this long and lonely highway that I travel every night, from Jackpot down to Ely, was like being in my hardest fight. Oh, Lord, my hardest fight. Never should have gone away from you. Oh, no, so far away.
That's Micky and the Motorcars with Long and Lonely Highway on BYU Radio. We're going to talk to Micky for just a minute. I think it's interesting to have this big musical heritage, and that might maybe open a door, but once you put your foot in there, you still have to bring it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So was there ever a time when you were a kid maybe that you thought, oh, everybody's saying, oh, I played with your dad, oh, I knew your grandpa. Did that ever bug you, or was that always cool?
No, it was always kind of a... more of a badge of honor than anything. We just it's really cool to grow up in a family that, whether you're farmers or doctors or whatever, we're musicians, and I think we take a lot of pride in it. And my dad and his dad, they're also third generation Idaho blood, so we also take a lot of pride in that, being from the West. And
I heard they just celebrated their 40th anniversary.
They did, yeah. We just actually all went over to Hawaii together, and we brought our wives over, and we got to hang out for a few, 5 or 6 days over there, and really had a great time. I'd never been over there before, so we had a blast. Got to do a little golfing, and you know how it is here in the West. It's cold this time of year, so to get over there and get some sunshine and hang out was pretty great.
Good. Well, that's your parents, Muzzy and Joanne. Mm-hmm. But who did your dad have you listen to when you were growing up?
It was a pretty large range of different stuff. We listened to anything from the Beach Boys to the Beatles to Merle Haggard and Johnny Cash, and then his friends too that play Pino Bennett and the famous Motel Cowboys. And we also went to a lot of the poetry gathering stuff that was kind of Elko, Nevada, which was really Western. So we saw
the cowboy poetry.
Yeah,
stuff.
Exactly. Like Baxter Black and Waddy Mitchell, and Riders in the Sky were, tons of people.
So, what was your mom wanting you to listen to?
Mom was a huge fan of Merle. That was her fave, kind of. Mm-hmm. But, you know, she liked Paul Overstreet and Don Williams. And mm-hmm. But she listened to us a lot, which was a little annoying on the ride into town. I'm not going to lie to you. But
we don't want to hear that again. You know, yeah. Merle Haggard, I mean, he's been, they talk about him as saying the guy who knew about hard living, uncertain love, and mm-hmm. workers ground down by depressing jobs.
Absolutely, yeah.
But what do you learn from someone like that? I mean, that's someone who, certain voices seem like they carry a lot mm-hmm. of baggage somehow.
Right.
Whether they've got it or not, their voice has it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I think the biggest thing I learned from him was songwriting, to be true to your songs and try, you know, if you can actually pull a song out and write it about a real life experience and have it reach thousands mm. of people, then you've either lived a pretty weird life or you've, you know, I guess you've done a lot in your life. And I think that's the biggest thing, is not being afraid to write about real stuff, whether it's embarrassing or whether it's the real deal. And I think that's what I've pulled out of his writing.
I think you guys probably must have been the coolest people on the block in high school, because you went around and you actually played in a band for different assemblies.
Yeah, we did.
Which was a lot of kids' dream. So what was that like, playing for people your very same age?
You know, it was interesting. I think
experience? Or?
You know, it was actually now for making a living is what it was, you know. Well, that's what we did. We traveled as a band. So that was Mom and Dad's way of making a living. And, you know, a lot of times playing those high schools was a lot of fun. And then a lot of times it was kind of embarrassing, really, because we were dressed up like cowboys and, and, you know, everybody else was wearing, you know, Nike tennis shoe high tops. Uh-huh. And we were kind of the dorks in a way, in our minds, you know. So, but
I thought everyone, you know, with a guitar was the cool guy.
Well, you know, that's what saved us. Now, we had a lot of fun, and it was a great experience, and it was fun playing. And I think that most of the assemblies really enjoyed seeing a family do what we were doing, and we had fun. But
hey, a last question on this subject, which is, do you think you learned really early how to deal with fans? I mean, not just performance on stage, but people who are a little starstruck or just really love your work and want to mm-hmm. say hi personally.
Yeah, I think definitely growing up as younger, it was a lot easier for us, because we basically was mind your P's and Q's, especially to adults. So my parents really raised us to be as polite as possible to anybody, no matter what the situation. So for us to grow up with people just coming up and wanting to get an autograph or shake our hands, it was, you know, we were always taught to be as nice as we could pull out of our hat. And that's, you know, I think, yeah, definitely it's helped me out down the line now, you know, when I've met a lot of really famous people, and most of them have been really gracious and nice, and there's been a few that definitely made you put a sour taste in your mouth, I guess. So,
well, set up this next song. We want to hear a Fall Apart.
Yeah, absolutely. I actually wrote this with my good friend Brian Keene, and we actually wrote it about kind of a spoiled girl growing up in Las Vegas, Nevada.
We don't need to name names. We'll have you take your... unless you want to shout it out in the middle of the song, we'll hardly notice. So here is Micky and the Motorcars. They're going to perform a song for us. This is called Fall Apart. Their website is mickyandthemotorcars.com. And if you go there, you'll be able to see some pretty cool videos. I think you'll have a good time with. We're here today hearing kind of the unplugged version, the acoustic version. So here is Fall Apart.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. She's on a roll, but she don't need money. A penthouse with no bills to pay. Life on the drag ain't always sunny, and it's hard to get from daddy's paying your way. All of the cops are sitting in his pocket. He takes a piece of everything. The
This set is her boat, she likes to rock it. Nobody ever says anything, but just one time she wants to dry her eyes and mean it and tell herself that she's down and out and believe it. She just wants to fall apart just so she can feel it. Yeah, so she can feel it. Just like the last one, money to spend and pills to take. Put it all on the line, let it pick your number. There's nothing to lose when you've got nothing at stake. Flipping pennies in a fountain across from El Dorado, watching armored trucks as they come and go. Oh, come on, girl, who do you think you're fooling with a Kerouac? Hitting the road, and just one time she wants to dry her eyes and mean it, tell herself that she's down and out and believe it. She just wants to fall apart just so she can feel it. Yeah, so she can feel it. Just so she can feel it. Yep.
That's Fall Apart, performed here in studio on BYU Radio. I'm Stephen Kapp Perry. Today in the studio, Micky and the Motorcars playing a more acoustic than usual set. They know how to kick it on stage. You need to check out their albums and their videos. But we are so glad they're here today. You'll find out why. We're especially glad today in just a minute. Gary, we got to hear you pull out the harmonica. That sounded great.
Thank you.
When you tour and you do 150 or 200 shows a year, I mean, it's not really nonstop. You're not on the road the whole year, but how do you organize that?
Well, we have a booking agent that schedules all everything for us and a management that helps out with all that. And then we try to go out never for more than a month, usually without getting home to see our wives or girlfriends or whatever else. Sometimes the family has to come out and meet us on the road for a weekend, you know, if it's because it's hard to drive all the way to Portland and then not play Seattle and work your way home, you know. It's like, so a lot of times we make a pretty good swing out of a run, and then we'll try to take it easier for
so
the next.
So you've got the tour bus, so you can sleep on the road. So who drives? Is that you guys, or you get a driver?
We have a driver that kind of takes care of it.
Designated driver, okay.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, he's definitely a
Are there any particular stretches driver of the U.S. maybe you don't want to say that, or that you think, okay, now would be a good time for the nap?
For the nap?
Yeah, for a nap rather than, I guess I'm thinking of less scenic parts, but maybe we don't want to mention any
West
states.
Yeah, I mean, you'd really be surprised. Every state out there has its own special places that's really beautiful. I mean, even in Texas, you know, outside of Austin, there's some pretty cool spots with good swimming holes and stuff to do.
And how do you deal with the same people day after day?
Oh, the band guys? We just kind of, well, that's a good question. We just try to respect each other enough, you know, as much as we can, and try to get out of each other's way if somebody's having a bad morning or a late night or whatever. You just kind of have to learn to live with each other, and it's kind of like being in the army or something, I guess.
Well, we saw on your Twitter feed, this is from back December a couple years ago, we had to put chains on for the last 50 miles. Took 3.5 hours to drive that far, but we're here, we're ready to play.
Yeah.
And I guess you do have to be sure you show up.
It was in Stephenville, and we probably should have canceled that show. it was, well, it was interesting. Well, it was one of those deals where we were driving, and the weather was getting bad, and the roads just kept getting worse and worse and worse, but we were in the middle of nowhere, and it was like, what if we can turn around and drive 50 miles backwards through the same stuff? So it was like we were kind of committed to it, and we should have been smarter and stopped before we chained up.
But you guys made it here this morning. Talk about commitment. I heard that the bus had a problem this morning.
Yeah, they're having trouble with the transmission cooler. The radiator had a little hole in it, so they had to pull it out and take it to a shop to get it repaired this morning, and so we just went over to the airport and rented a car and stripped it down even more from a 5-piece to a 3-piece.
We appreciate the commitment. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having
us. Hey, we could not help but notice lots of baseball pictures.
Yeah, we're big baseball fans.
And not just hats.
Yeah.
Like entire uniforms, like special baseball boots.
Yeah, I got those on right now. My brothers and I, we grew up playing baseball in rural Idaho, and we didn't have a TV and stuff, so we kind of were really into baseball. And my mom wouldn't let us play football because we were too hard on each other. And so we just kind of started watching baseball as we got older. And when we go to towns, if we get an opportunity to catch a game, it's always cool to go to see a new park.
So are you all cheering for the same team? Or
Micky and I are Dodger fans. And my brother Cody likes the Yankees. And Willie likes the Red Sox. And Dustin was Houston. Are you?
Yeah.
Astros
okay,
fans.
So that's not part of the audition process, is who's your team?
No, but it probably should be.
Hey, thank you very much. We want to hear a song about, this song is called Casino, so I have to set it up with the best casino story I know, which is that my friend, his parents used to take him from Utah to California to visit family every year, and they stopped for the really cheap breakfast at Caesar's Palace. And there, where you could eat all you wanted for like a buck or two at the time. Right. And they're always walking past all of the machines, and they're saying, "Mom, I've got my own quarter. You gotta let me gamble." Right. And she'd say, Boys, you know, you lose your money." And finally, she had just had enough. She said, "Give me that quarter." She goes over, she puts it in the slot machine, pulls the thing, and of course, like $30 worth of quarters, which to them was $1 million anyway, that's my one casino story. So we're going to hear this song from Micky and the Motorcars. It's Casino.
Yeah. All right. 1, 2, 3.
I shouldn't have come here on a roll of the dice. I shouldn't have bet more than it takes to survive. I got half the money to get out of this town. If I could just double what I have on me now and roll on, big casino, like you always do. All the girls and this hotel, I leave them for you. You know I'm a loser, but tonight I might win just enough to get out of this miserable city of sin. I came on a hot streak. It was my lucky day. I had some traveling money. I should have walked away. But I swear I could feel it when I doubled it down. And then I couldn't believe it when my luck had run out. So roll on, big casino, like you always do. All the girls and the hotel, I leave them for you. You know I'm a loser, and tonight I might win just enough to get out of this miserable city of sin. Roll on, big casino, like you always do. girls and that hotel. I leave them for you. You know I'm a loser, and tonight I might win just enough to get out of this miserable city of sin, this miserable city I'm in.
Casino live on Highway 89. Today in studio, we've had Micky and the Motorcars, brothers Micky and Gary Braun on vocals and acoustic guitar, guitarist Dustin Shaefer on lead, from the Sawtooth Mountains of Stanley, Idaho, to downtown Nashville and Austin city limits. Micky and the Motorcars do over 200 gigs a year, jamming all over the U.S. They've released 7 full-length records so far, including their latest, Heart from Above. Tour information and videos can be seen online at mickyandthemotorcars.com. Thank you guys for coming in, Micky. We appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having us. It's been a blast.
Hey, we get our own little concert here. We love to hear from you, our listeners. You can send a comment or find out about the show. Watch any episode at your leisure at byuradio.org/highway89. Highway 89 is a production of BYU Broadcasting in Provo, Utah. The recording engineer is Mark Waite. Our student assistant is Abby Horlocker. And our show's producer is Jackie Tateishi. I'm Stephen Kapp Perry. Thanks for listening.